Time magazine called him the unsung hero behind the internet. CNN called him a father of the internet. President Bill Clinton called him one of the great minds of the information age. He has been voted history's greatest scientist of African descent. He is Philip Emeagwali. He's coming to Trinidad and Tobago to launch the 2008 Kwame Ture Lecture Series on Sunday, June 8th at the JFK Auditorium, Union Center Westin, 5 p.m. The Emancipation Support Committee invites you to come and hear this inspirational mind adjust the theme, crossing new frontiers to conquer today's challenges. This lecture is one you cannot afford to miss. Admission is free, so be there on Sunday, June 8th, 5 p.m. at the JFK Auditorium, New East Saint Augustine.
When I began scalar supercomputing on June 20, 1974 in Corvallis, Oregon, United States, scalar processing, or the one-step-at-a-time serial computer approach, was the frontier of knowledge of supercomputers. In 1974, vector processing was the next generation technology for supercomputers. In 1974, parallel processing, or solving many problems at once instead of solving them one by one, was an unknown land to all supercomputer scientists. In the 1970s, parallel processing was embroiled in controversies, and countless ridiculing statements were made about the technology. I was not surprised when my first lecture on massively parallel processing had only one attendee. That lecture was in November 1982 in an auditorium that was a short walk from the White House in Washington, D.C. That attendee was an eccentric-looking mid-thirties white male in cowboy regalia that included cowboy boots, a bolo tie, and a Texan hat. The second reason my lecture on massively parallel processing drew only one attendee was that it was known in advance that I was young and black. That was unpublished and unproven. White male scientists who began conducting research before I was born are not likely to listen to the discoveries of a young black African scientific researcher that was unpublished and unproven. In the early 1980s, the theoretical analysis of extreme scale computational physics codes didn't meet up to publication standards and were offhandedly rejected. It was until the 4th of July of 1989 that I could experimentally prove that massively parallel processing works. To those white scientists, I was trespassing in a space, a technological terra incognita that wasn't mine. My discovery story was rejected because it wasn't their discovery story. To many white historians of science, a black inventor is a myth until he becomes a white inventor. I've sat for a published portrait in which the white illustrator portrayed me as a white inventor and did so to make me acceptable to his white readers. When I gave my lectures in 1982, the massively parallel processing supercomputer was ridiculed by everybody. A story in the June 14, 1976 issue of the Computer World magazine was captured, quote, "Research in parallel processing questioned as waste of time," unquote. My supercomputing quest was to make the fictional factual. I began supercomputing from the realm of science fiction. I began supercomputing from the realm of a fictionalized 2^16 processors that were married together as one cohesive internet and married by 16 times 2^16 email wires that encircled a globe in a 16-dimensional hyperspace. I began supercomputing on Thursday, June 20, 1974 in Corvallis, Oregon, United States. I began supercomputing not as a supercomputer scientist, but as a mathematician that was more at home with non-Euclidean geometry and topology than with a single processor. I began supercomputing as a mathematical physicist that was exposed to the four-dimensional space-time continuum of Albert Einstein's theory of relativity. Because I began supercomputing from theoretical physics, I found it easier to accept extra-dimensional thinking that was then taboo in engineering science. My technological quest for massively parallel processing that makes computers faster and makes supercomputers fastest demanded that I think in 16 dimensions. My quest for the new supercomputer knowledge that will make the new supercomputer fastest demanded that I imagine a one-to-one correspondence between the bidirectional edges of the cube in the 16th dimension and the 16 times 2^16 email wires of my new internet that encircled a globe that I visualized in the 16th dimension. Also, my quest for the new knowledge that will make the new internet, that is a new supercomputer, fastest, demanded that I imagine and then that I visualize another one-to-one correspondence between the 2^16 vertices of the cube in the 16th dimension. Since I was programming all 65,536 processors and programming them blindfolded, I had to correctly visualize where each processor was located in my 16th dimension and located with respect to the other processors. I imagined my ensemble as one cohesive supercomputer that's a parallel processing machine that's de facto a small copy of the internet. That new internet was a small copy of a never-before-understood internet that had only 65,536 processors around a globe instead of billions of computers around a globe. In the 1970s, my parallel processing machine was science fiction. The belief that the technology was science fiction gave rise to the saying, "Parallel processing is a beautiful theory that lacked experimental confirmation." A theory is an idea that's not positively true. Yet, the 16th dimensional that sounded like science fiction to the petroleum engineer of the 1970s that explores oil and gas in the everyday three-dimensional world also sounds like fact to a mathematician used to thinking in infinite-dimensional subspaces. The 16th dimensional that sounded like a science fiction to the computational physicist of the 1970s also sounds like a fact to a theoretical physicist that routinely imagines multi-dimensional string theory or multi-universes or universes with different laws of physics. I was a civil engineer, an engineering physicist who helped operate dams, reservoirs, and power plants that were along the North Platte River of Wyoming, United States. That intellectual difference between the theoretical physicist and the practical engineer made it easier for me, Philip Emeagwali, that was both a theoretical physicist and a practical engineer, to change the way I thought we could make new supercomputers faster.
Insightful and brilliant lecture.